Good morning, students. Since the earliest times, humans have dreamt of conquering the skies. And here we have the two stories which tells us about flying. The first one is written by Liam O'Flaherty, and the title of the story is His Flight. In this story, Liam O'Flaherty talks about a young seagull who is afraid to fly. How does he conquer his fear? That is what the story is about. In the second story, which is under the title of Black Aeroplane, which was written by Frederick Forsyth, he talks about a pilot who is lost in the storm clouds. Does he arrive safe? Who helps him? That is what the second story is all about. But before we start this stories, let's do some warm up. Now recall your memory when you started to learn bicycle. How your parents, your family supported you to learn it? What was your experience? You might have fallen many times, resulting into many scars and bruises. But then, have you stopped to learn it? The answer is no. Even if it hurt you badly, you never stopped it. And finally, you made it. And when you do so, you might have felt that you have conquered the great battle. You have achieved something great. And the joy which you might felt was indescribable. Here, in this story, his first flight, we are going to talk about this young seagull. Now, seagull is an aquatic bird who has a very short height. It has a very long wings. It can float, it can fly, and it has a very gray and white feathers. And this bird was meant to fly and float. But here, it was afraid to take its first flight because he has a fear that he might fall. His wings would never support him. That kind of fear he felt. And due to this fear, it was unable to take its flight. In this story, Liam O'Flaherty has well described the agony, the dilemma, the inner conflict of this young seagull. The story tells us that nothing is hard if we conquer over our fear, if we overcome with our fear. So, let's start this story. Isn't it interesting? But before this, we start the story, let's be familiar with the writer, that is Liam O'Flaherty. So, basically he was born in 1896 and died in 1984, and he was an Irish novelist and a short story writer and a major figure in the Irish literary renaissance. Now, Irish literary renaissance is the movement where Irish writers took up the Irish language at their base and they started writing in Irish language, focusing on the Irish people and their lifestyles and their cultures. That is what Irish literary renaissance. And he was one of the major figure in that. He was founding member of the Communist Party of the Ireland even. A native Irish speaker from the Gaeltacht, O'Flaherty wrote almost exclusively in English, expert for small number of short stories in the Irish language. So apart from Irish language, apart from Irish language stories and all the things, he has written in English even, and that is very exclusively. So he has a very good command over English and the Irish. He spent most of his time in traveling and lived comfortably and quietly outside the spotlight. So that means he doesn't like city life and spotlight, limelight, right? So he lives very peacefully, very calmly and very comfortably without any kind of disturbance. Maybe that is the reason that he can think about a seagull. So the young seagull was alone on his ledge. I'm reading the story. The young seagull was alone on his ledge. His two brothers and his sisters had already flown away. The day before, he had been afraid to fly with them. Somehow, when he had taken a little run forward to the brink of the ledge and run and attempted to flap his wings, he became afraid. The great expanse of sea stretched down beneath, and it was such a long way down, miles down. Okay. So this story is all, as we know, that it is about the young seagull. So he was very alone on his ledge. Now ledge is a very narrow horizontal shelf projecting from a wall. Here is of a cliff. So it is a very narrow horizontal shelf over a cliff. So he was there and he was very alone. Why he was alone? Because his two brothers and his sister, they had already flown away the day before. So all these his siblings are flown away the day before, and he was all alone on that ledge. He had been afraid to fly with them. Now the only thing was that he was very afraid to fly with them. Somehow, when he had taken a little run forward to the brink of the ledge. Now what is brink? Brink is the extreme edge of land before a steep slope or a body of a water. So he was at the end of that cliff. So he was at the brink of the ledge, and he ran towards it at the brink, to the brink of the ledge, and he even attempted to flap his wings. But what happened? He became afraid. Why he became afraid? The answer is given in these lines. Because the great expanse of sea, expanse that means a very wide continuous area of something. So there was a very wide area of the sea which was stretched down beneath. So he was at the cliff, and beneath this cliff, anyone could see this expanse, the wide area of the sea. And it was such a long way down, miles down. So that cliff was of a very, it was situated at a very high. Right, so the sea is a very long way down. It's just it feels like a miles down to the young seagull. You can see that scene in the picture. It is at the brink of this cliff, and the miles down you will see this sea. And all the siblings were opposite to him. They were already flown away. So they were not with this seagull. It was all alone. He felt certain that his wings would never support him. So what was the biggest fear for him? The sea was there beneath this cliff. but above all he feels that his wings would never support him. So that is what his fear. So he bent his head. So he even fluttered his wings, right? So what happened that suddenly he stopped at that brink of this cliff and he looked down, and what he could see this great expanse of the sea, and he feels that it was miles down. And so what happened that then? So he bent his head and ran away back to the little hole under the ledge where he slept at night. So he gets so much afraid and he got so much disappointed that he bent his head and he ran back towards his place. What was his place? A hole under the ledge where he slept last night. Because he was alone the day before, his siblings were already flown away. So he slept alone at the night. Even when each of his brothers and his sisters, even when each of his brothers and his little sister, whose wings were far shorter than his own, ran to the brink, flapped their wings, and flew away, they failed to muster up courage to take the plunge which appeared to him so desperate. His father and mother had come around calling to him shrilly, upbraiding him, threatening to let him starve on his ledge unless he flew away, but for the life of him he could not move. Now let's understand it line by line. So even when each of his brothers and his little sisters, whose wings were were far shorter than his own, ran to the brink, flapped their wings and flew away. So what happened that his brothers, his sisters, his little sisters, so all his siblings, their wings were far shorter than this seagull. But though, despite of this shortness of their wings, these siblings were able to muster up the courage. They ran back, they ran towards this brink, they flapped their wings and they all flew away. But this seagull, it was failed to muster up. Muster up, that means gather up. So he was failed to gather the courage to take that plunge. Plunge, that means that dive, that jump. Okay, so he was failed to dive, which appeared to him so desperate. So he was very desperately doing that things, but he was not able to get, not able to gather the courage, not able to muster up this courage, unlike his brothers and his little sister. His father and mother had come around calling him shrilly. Now shrilly is a very high pitch and piercing voice or a sound of this seagull. So all his parents, right, both the parents, they all came around him calling him shrilly. They all call him, upbraiding him, threatening to let him starve on his ledge unless he flew away. So parents were even threatening this seagull that you have to fly away, you have to dive, you have to take a plunge, otherwise you have to starve, we will not give you any kind of food, so you have to starve. So despite of this threatening, he was not able to gather up some courage. but for the life of him, he could not move it. So he was very afraid of it. Upbraiding, that means scold. So the parents scolded even him, right? Threatening him, scolding him, but he was not able to do any of this. Now, comprehension check. Why did the seagull fail to fly? Okay, now the seagull failed to fly because now there are two reasons at that. He has not, he felt that his wings would never support him. And the first reason was that he was at the cliff, and that beneath that cliff there was a very vast sea was there, and it was the miles down, right? So that is the reason he was afraid and he couldn't gather up some courage and he failed to fly. What did the parents do when the young seagull failed to fly? So when this young seagull failed to fly, they threatened him, they scold him, they taunt him, and they even threatened him that if you don't try, then you will have to starve, right? So this kind of actions his parents has taken. Moving further, that was 24 hours ago. Since then, nobody had come near him. So before 24 hours, these parents and everyone has scolded him. Even the brothers and the sister, they took their flight and they all flew away from that leech, from that place. So it passed 24 hours hours period. So the day has passed, and since then nobody had come near him. So he was all alone there. The day before, all day long, so throughout the day, what happened? He had watched his parents flying about with his brothers and sister, perfecting them in the art of flight, teaching them how to skim the waves and how to dive for the fish. He had in fact seen his older brother catch his flight herring and devour it, standing on a rock while his parents circled around raising a proud crackle. And all the morning the whole family had walked about on the big plateau midway down the opposite cliff, taunting him with his cowardice. Okay, now let's see it line by line. So the 24 hours has passed, and since then nobody came there near him, right? So he was all alone. And the day before, what happened? So 24 hours before, what happened? That all day, the day before, what happened? The all day long, so throughout the day, he had watched. So he was just watching. What was he watching? He was watching his parents, and they were flying with his brothers and sisters. So his parents were flying with the brothers and sisters, and they were perfecting them in the arts of the flight. So they were teaching them how to fly. They were teaching them how to skim the waves and how to dive for fish. So they were teaching him to pray even. So how to catch a fish. They were teaching them everything to their siblings. He had in fact seen his older brother catching his first herring. Herring, that means a वेरी सॉफ्ट फिंड सी फिश. सो ही हैज़ इवन सीन दैट हिज ओल्डर ब्रदर, हिज ब्रदर हैज़ कैच दिस फर्स्ट हैरिंग, फर्स्ट फिश, एंड हाउ एंड ही डिवोर इट इवन. सो ही ईट इट वेरी क्विकली द ब्रदर. स्टैंडिंग ऑन अ रॉक वाइल हिज पेरेंट्स सर्कल्ड अराउंड रेजिंग अ प्राउड कैकल. कैकल दैट मीन्स अ वेरी लाफ इन अ लाउड हार्श. सो स्टैंडिंग ऑन अ रॉक हिज पेरेंट्स सर्कल्ड अराउंड रेजिंग अ प्राउड कैकल. सो द ब्रदर वॉज स्टैंडिंग ऑन दैट रॉक. ही वॉज फीलिंग हैप्पीनेस. He was feeling pride, and even not even this brother, but even the parents were feeling proud for their kid, right? For their son, right? Not a son, of course. It is that chick, right? But here, the writer has considered this seagull as a human being. It is described as a he, not as a it. Okay, so maybe that's the reason. Okay, fine. So he has watched all these things throughout the day. So he has seen these things, that how their parents taught his siblings to they were all perfecting the flight, so how to fly, and they were all parents were even teaching them to scheme the waves and how to dive for the fish. And even his one of the brother, his older brother, was able to catch his first fish, that is herring, right? And even he devoured it. And when he do so, he was on the standing on the rock, and his parents were circling around that seagull, and they were all feeling very proud, and they makes very proud cackle over there. And all the morning, the whole family had walked about on a big plateau midway down the opposite cliff, taunting him with his cowardice. Okay, so what happened then? Then all morning, this whole family except this young seagull, they all left him. They all moved to this big plateau, and it was located midway down, so that when the seagull was there on the cliff. Okay, so from the that cliff midway down, there was the another cliff that which was opposite to that cliff. And they were all went there, they were all walked there, and they were very, they were even taunting him with his cowardice. So everyone is taunting him with his cowardice. He is very coward. He hasn't any bravery. The sun was now ascending the sky, blazing on his ledge that faced the south. He felt the heat because he had not eaten since the previous nightfall. He stepped slowly out to the brink of the ledge, and standing on one leg with the other leg hidden under his wing, he closed one eye, then the other, and pretended to be falling asleep. Still, they took no notice of him. He saw his two brothers and his sisters lying on the plateau, dozing with their heads sunk into their necks. His father was preening the feathers on his white back. Only his mother was looking at him. She was standing on a little high hump on the plateau, her vast breast thrust forward. Okay, let's understand it one by one. Now, The sun was now ascending the sky. Ascending the sky, that means the act of rising up through the air. Okay, so now the sun was rising up and blazing on his ledge. Now it was blazing on his ledge that faced south. Now that ledge was facing the south. He felt the heat. Now sun was blazing, so of course he felt some heat, and he felt more heat because he had not eaten since the previous nightfall. So last day the whole family walked out to another plateau, another cliff which was opposite to him, opposite to his ledge, and it was even midway down to that cliff. Right now the night has passed, and now the sun was ascending the sky. The sun was rising up and it was blazing on that ledge which was faced the south, and he felt this heat because he had not eaten since the previous nightfall. So his parents were threatening him that we will not give you any kind of food. That was the reality. It was not just the false threatening. It was a very true and genuine, sincere threatening. So he was hungry, he was starving, he has not eaten anything since previous nightfall. He stepped slowly out to the brink of the ledge. So he stepped slowly out to the brink of that ledge, and standing on one leg with the other leg hidden under his wing, he closed one eye then the other and pretended to be falling asleep. So he started acting. He pretend to be falling asleep. And still they took no notice of him. So he pretend. So when these parents or other people, if they don't notice the kid, these things will happen. So same thing is here. So he tried to be noticeable, but no one took a notice of it. Okay. So he saw his two brothers and his sister lying on the plateau, and he saw that his brothers and his sisters, they were lying on that plateau and they were dozing with their heads sunk into their necks. So it is their way to sleep. So they were all taking a dose of dozing, and they were all sleeping. His father was preening the feathers on his white back. Preening, that means to tidy and clean up its feathers. So the father was preening the feathers. He was tidying and cleaning its feathers on his white back. Only his mother was looking at him. Okay, so now the at least mother is there who is looking at him. Okay, let's see what happened next. She was standing on a little high hump. Okay, hump, that means a rounded raised mass of earth or land. Okay, so she was standing on that little high hump on that plateau, and her white breast thrust forward. So the mother was looking towards this young seagull, and she was facing him, right? Now and again she tore a piece of fish that lay at her feet, and then scraped each side of her beak on the rock. The sight of their food maddened him. How he loved to tear food that way, scraping his beak now and again to wet it. So now and again, what the mother is doing there, she was tearing a piece. So she tore a piece. She was tearing. Okay. So she tore a piece of fish that lay at her feet. So at her feet there was a fish, and she was tearing a piece of fish from that fish, and then scrap, that means discard, and scrap each side of her beak on the rock. So he is discarding his beak, each side of her beak on the rock. The sight of the food maddened him. So he was hungry, he was starving. And when this young seagull saw that food, so it maddened him. He became crazy, he became mad. How he loved to tear the food that way. So he loved to tear the food that way. And this sight makes him mad, scraping his beak now and again to wet it. So the way the mother was tearing a piece of fish, and the way it was scraping each side of her beak, this young seagull loves to do it. And even the food was there, he was very starving. He has eaten nothing from the last previous night, right? So he is very hungry, and when he saw this food, he becomes mad. There is a proverb which says that hungry man is always an angry man. So he becomes very mad here. Okay, comprehension check. What was the first catch of the young seagull's older brother? Okay, it was a finning. Finning is a kind of fish, right? So he catch a finning. What did the young seagull manage to find in his search for food on the ledge? I think it is not given yet. We will see in the next para. What did the young bird do to seek the attention of his parents? Okay, so the young bird went to that edge of that, he walked towards that brink of this ledge, and he was standing over on the one leg, and he hide his one of the leg under its wings, and then he closed his one eye and the second eye. So he pretended to be taking a sleep. So that kind of thing he has done to seek the attention of his parents. What made the young seagull go mad? So the answer could be like that. The mother was facing towards this young seagull, and under his feet there was a fish, and the mother tore a piece of a fish, and now and again she used to scrap each side of her beak on the rock. So these things made this young seagull go mad. Okay, so I think in this first part we will see this things only. Write down your comprehension sections also. I would like to tell you one thing, that students, please read the lesson, which it will help you to write down, to fill the vocabulary. Okay, so FIB would be there, and for that you have to prepare. No doubt options would be there in the examination, in the question paper, but it would be better if you have read the story once, twice. You will get the idea that after these things happen. So you will get the you will know that at which where to write what exact word. Second thing, as I told you that from the grammar part even, that in the grammar part, in the examination, you will find the questions related to grammar, but they are taken from our literature textbook. Okay, so that is the reason there. The so total 16 plus 16, so you can say that almost 30 to 32 marks you will you have to cover from this literature textbook. Other 32 marks, that would be of comprehension and composition, right? Which is totally creative and based on the comprehension things. Okay, so it is out of the text, right? And these 32 marks you can get it from the text. Grammar stuff, as I told you, grammar stuffs are there, but majorly, most of it, they used to ask from the literature textbooks. Okay, so that's the thing. Thank you very much. Keep reading.